Hey friends, welcome to the YouTube channel All About Electronics. So in this video, we will understand how to do the small signal analysis of the BJT. So this small signal analysis is particularly useful when the BJT is used as an amplifier. So using this small signal analysis, we can find or estimate the different amplifier parameters like the voltage gain, input and the output impedance. Now during the small signal analysis, we are assuming that the input to the amplifier is very small, typically in the range of microvolt to millivolt. And indeed, when the BJT is used as an amplifier or the preamplifier, then the input is coming from either microphone or from the antenna. Now we know that to use the BJT as an amplifier, we need to bias it. So when we apply the input signal to the BJT, then it should not affect the biasing condition of the BJT. Similarly, this biasing voltage should not affect the input signal. So to isolate the input signal and the biasing voltage, this coupling capacitor is used. Or in other words, the input signal is applied to the BJT via this coupling capacitor. So as you are aware, the capacitor blocks the DC signal, because for the DC signal, it will act as an open circuit. So if you are aware, the reactance of the capacitor can be given as 1 divided by 2 pi times fc, and for the DC voltage, the frequency f is equal to 0. That means the reactance of the capacitor will be infinite, and hence it will act as an open circuit. At the same time, this capacitor allows the AC signal to pass through it. And if the value of the capacitor is selected properly, then at the operating frequency, the reactance offered by the capacitor will be minimum. And for simplicity, we can assume that for the AC signal, this capacitor acts as a short circuit. Similarly, at the output side, to block the DC voltage from the output signal, the coupling capacitors are used. So that is the basic function of the coupling capacitor, that is to isolate the AC and the DC signals. And perhaps you might have seen these coupling capacitors in the transistor circuit. For example, in this circuit, this capacitor C1 and C2 are the coupling capacitors. Alright, so now let us see the steps which we need to follow for the small signal analysis of the BJT. And for the simplicity, let us take the example of the common emitter fixed bias configuration. That means in this configuration, the BJT is used as an amplifier in the common emitter configuration. So here, the common emitter means the emitter terminal is common between the input and the output side. That means here, the input signal is applied between the base and the emitter, while the output is taken between the collector and the emitter terminal. And for the biasing, the BJT is biased in the fixed bias configuration. So that is what I mean by the common emitter fixed bias configuration. Alright, so now let us see the steps for the small signal analysis. So first of all, consider all the DC sources in the circuit as zero. So as I said earlier, the input signal which is applied to this BJT amplifier is very small. So under the small signal approximation, we can apply the principle of the superposition, and we can consider the AC and the DC sources separately for the analysis. That means during the AC analysis or for the small signal analysis, we can consider all the DC sources as zero. So we can consider all the DC voltage sources as a short circuit, while we can consider all the current sources as the open circuit. Then the second step is to replace all the coupling and the bypass capacitor with the short circuit. And then the third step is to replace the BJT with the small signal model. So one by one, let us follow all these steps and let us do the small signal analysis of the given circuit. So the first step is to consider all the DC sources in the circuit as zero. That means this voltage source VCC will act as a short circuit, and it will directly get connected to the ground terminal. Then the next step is to replace the coupling capacitors by the short circuit. That means we can replace this capacitor C1 and C2 by the short circuit. And then the third step is to replace the BJT by the small signal model. So this is the small signal model of the BJT. And if we consider the early effect, then we also need to include the output resistance in this small signal model. But for a moment, let us assume that the output resistance is infinite. And considering this, now let us replace the BJT by the small signal model. Now, if you see over here, then the input signal is applied between the base and the emitter terminal. That means we can represent the input voltage between these two terminals, right? Now, if you see over here, then the one terminal of this resistor RB is connected to the base terminal, while the second terminal is connected to the ground, which is the AC ground. And if you see over here, this emitter terminal is grounded. So effectively, we can say that this resistor RB is connected between the base and the emitter terminal, right? Similarly, we can say that this collector resistor RC is connected between the collector and the emitter terminal. That means we can represent this resistor RB and RC between the base emitter and the collector emitter terminals. So this is the AC equivalent representation of the common emitter fixed bias configuration. And using this, we can find the different amplifier parameters like the voltage gain, the input and the output impedance. And first of all, let us find the voltage gain. So let's say the current which is flowing through this resistor RC is equal to I naught. So if we apply the KCL at this node, then we can say that this collector current IC is equal to I naught. And this current I naught can be given as minus V naught divided by RC. That means we can say that the output voltage V out is equal to minus IC times RC. And we know that this collector current IC can be given as GM times V pi. That means V out is equal to minus GM times V pi times RC. Now, if you see over here, then this input voltage V in is equal to V pi, right? That means we can replace this voltage V pi by the input voltage. And we can say that the ratio of the V out by V in is equal to minus GM times RC. That is equal to the voltage gain. That means the voltage gain is equal to minus GM times RC, where this GM is the transconductance and it can be given as the IC divided by VT, where IC is the DC collector current and the VT is the thermal voltage. Now if you observe over here, then there is a negative sign in this voltage gain. That means there is a 180 degree phase shift between the input and the output voltage. So similarly, now let us find the expression of the input impedance. So if Vin is the input voltage and Iin is the input current, then the ratio of this input voltage to the input current is equal to the input impedance, right? So here, if we apply the KCL at this node, then we can write it as this Iin is equal to Vin divided by RB plus Vin divided by R pi. That means input current Iin is equal to Vin times 1 divided by RB plus 1 divided by R pi. That means the ratio of the input voltage to the input current, that is the input impedance, is equal to 1 divided by RB plus 1 divided by R pi. Or we can say that it is the parallel combination of the RB and the R pi. So this is the expression of the input impedance. And similarly, now let us find the expression of the output impedance. So the output impedance is the Thevenin's equivalent impedance which is seen through the output terminal. And for that, let us consider all the independent sources in the circuit as zero. That means for that, we can replace this input voltage Vin by the short circuit. Now, as soon as we replace this input voltage by the short circuit, then these two resistors will also get short circuited. And at the same time, this collector current IC will also become zero, because this voltage V pi will also become zero. That means we can say that this dependent current source will act as an open circuit. That means now the Thevenin's equivalent resistance which is seen through the output terminal is equal to RC. Or we can say that the output impedance is equal to RC. So from this small signal equivalent circuit, we got the expression of the voltage gain, the input impedance and the output impedance. That means the voltage gain is equal to minus GM times RC, while the input impedance is the parallel combination of the RB and the RPi. And similarly, the output impedance is equal to RC. Now, so far in our discussion, we have assumed that the output resistance in this small signal model is infinite. But if we also consider this output resistance, then these expressions will get modified. So now, with this output resistance, if you see, this resistor RC and R0 are in parallel. So now, the voltage gain can be given as minus GM times RC parallel R0. And similarly, the output impedance Z0 will be equal to R0 parallel RC. But in this case, the input impedance Zin will remain the same. That is the parallel combination of RPi and the RB. So because of this output resistance R0, there will be a slight modification in the overall expressions. But if the value of R0 is very high, then we can neglect the effect of this R0. Alright, so this was the small signal analysis of the common emitter fixed bias configuration. And similarly, now let us do the small signal analysis for the common emitter voltage divider biasing configuration. So here, these capacitors C1 and C2 are the coupling capacitors, while this capacitor C3 is the bypass capacitor. So for the DC voltages, this bypass capacitor will act as an open circuit, while for the AC input signal, it offers the minimum resistance. And for the analysis, we can assume that for the AC signal, it will act as a short circuit. Alright, so now let us do the AC analysis of the given circuit. And for that, we will follow the same three steps. That means first of all, consider all the DC voltage sources in the circuit as zero. Then after, replace all the coupling and the bypass capacitors by the short circuit. And as a third step, replace the BJT by the small signal model. So here, as this capacitor C3 acts as a short circuit, so this emitter resistor RE will also get short circuited. That means we can say that this emitter terminal will get grounded, right? Now if you see over here, then effectively this input voltage is applied between the base and the emitter terminal. That means in the AC equivalent circuit, there will be an input signal between the base and the emitter terminal. Apart from that, if you see over here, then the one terminal of this resistor R2 is connected to the base terminal, while the second terminal is connected to the ground. Similarly, the one terminal of this resistor R1 is connected to the base terminal, while the second terminal is connected to the AC ground. Or effectively, we can say that these two resistors are connected between the base and the emitter terminal, because here, this emitter terminal will get grounded, right? Similarly, we can say that this resistor RC is connected between the collector and the emitter terminal. So considering all these things, if we see the AC equivalent circuit, then it will look like this. That means here, the resistor R1 and R2 are connected between the base and the emitter terminal, while the resistor RC is connected between the collector and the emitter terminal. So now, let us find the voltage gain, the input and the output impedance from this equivalent circuit. And first of all, let us find out the voltage gain. So from the output side, we can say that the voltage Vout is equal to minus IC times R0 parallel RC. And here IC is equal to GM times Vpi. That means we can say that Vout is equal to minus GM times Vpi times R0 parallel RC. And here the voltage Vpi is equal to input voltage. That means we can say that the ratio of the output voltage to the input voltage is equal to minus GM times R0 parallel RC. So this is the expression of the voltage gain. That means the voltage gain is equal to minus GM times R0 parallel RC. And once again, if you see, there is a negative sign in the voltage gain, which indicates there is a 180 degree phase shift between the input and the output signal. So similarly, now let us find the expression of the input impedance. So as I said, the input impedance can be given as the input voltage to the input current, where input current is the current which is supplied by the input voltage. So to find the input impedance, let us apply the KCL at this node. That means we can say that this input current is equal to Vin divided by R1 plus Vin divided by R2 plus Vin divided by R pi. Or we can say that the ratio of the input voltage to the input current, that is the input impedance, is the parallel combination of the R1, R2 and the R pi. That is equal to R1 in parallel with R2 in parallel with R pi. So this is the expression of the input impedance. And here, if the parallel combination of R1 and R2 is much greater than the R pi, in that case, the input impedance Zin will be approximately equal to R pi. Alright, so similarly, now let us find the expression of the output impedance. So as I said earlier, the output impedance is the Thevenin's equivalent impedance which is seen through the output terminal. And to find that, let us consider all the independent sources in the circuit as zero. That means to find the output impedance, we need to consider this input voltage Vin as the zero. That means we can replace this input voltage Vin by the short circuit. So as soon as we consider this input voltage Vin as zero, all these three resistors will get short circuited. And at the same time, this current source will also become zero. Or we can say that it will act as an open circuit. So in that condition, the Thevenin's equivalent resistance which is seen through the output terminal is the parallel combination of R0 and the RC. Or we can say that the output impedance is equal to the parallel combination of R0 and the RC. So in this way, we got the expression of the voltage gain, the input impedance and the output impedance for the common emitter voltage divider biasing configuration. And we will solve some examples based on the small signal analysis on our second channel. Now, so far in our analysis, we have assumed that there is a bypass capacitor in the amplifier circuit. But if we remove this bypass capacitor, then the circuit analysis will get changed completely. So in the next video, we will see that how to analyze such circuits when there is a no bypass capacitor. But I hope in this video you understood how to do the small signal analysis of the common emitter fixed bias and the voltage divider biasing configuration. So if you have any question or suggestion, do let me know here in the comment section below. If you like this video, hit the like button and subscribe to the channel for more such videos.